ladies and gentlemen, it's a great pleasure to talk a little bit about the Munich porcelain collection. I would really like to thank Julia Weber and the Staatliche Kunstsammlung Dresden for the kind invitation and for this opportunity. Significant parallels to be drawn in view of the collecting strategies of Augustus the Strong and Maximilian of Bavaria, two electors with mutual royal pretensions. Examining the decisive role of Maximilian's advisors, dealers, and trade networks, the specific profile of his porcelain collection comes to the fore, but there will be also interesting differing aspects with regards to Augustus's approach to porcelain. I will cut short the early history of collecting porcelain in Munich. In the late 16th century, the Wittelsbach used their dynastic relations to Spain and Portugal. And for instance, in 1598, there were 195 pieces of Krag porcelain inventoried in Munich. However, this was all looted by the Swedes in 1632, and you might find these pieces in Stockholm and Gotha. Max Emanuel's mother, Henriette Adelaide of Savoy, was interested in East Asian artwork, and interestingly, she bought lacquer and mounted porcelain from Augsburg merchants. So we never should underestimate the role of Augsburg for southern German supply of porcelain. Yet, the direct impact of the Protestant Dutch States General lacked in order to develop a true fashion for the Chinese style. This will change due to the political biography of Elector Max Emanuel when he was made Governor General of the Spanish Netherlands in 1691 and held court at Brussels. After that time, the change from his agrarian homeland, Bavaria, still impoverished by the impact of the 30 Years' War, into one of the richest cultural landscapes in Europe, caused a positive shock on the elector and his courtiers, if you like. He was most impressed by the dynamism of the city of Antwerp as a metropolis of arts and commerce. And at the same time, he began to emulate the Netherlandish way in collecting pictures and East Asian porcelain. Within a year, he owned his own collection, for which in 1694, a so-called Dutch cabinet was created in the Munich Residence Palace. This new type of collector's cabinet, furnished with lacquer panels and mirrors, was directly influenced by the model of Daniel Marot, who since 1685 had created such cabinets for William III of Orange. In fact, Max Emanuel had sent his Munich architect Enrico Zuccalli to Holland to inspect the newest designs at William's court. And the fact that the elector's desire was so soon to have a Chinese-style cabinet is in fact symptomatic for his profile as a princely collector, because he would not content himself with the bourgeois requisites of the China fashion in Brussels or Antwerp. The first point of reference was the court culture of the Prince of Orange, with whom he was on cordial terms. The newly acquired porcelains were most likely Dutch imports, which he acquired, I believe, via intermediate vendors in the Spanish Netherlands or during trips of his courtiers to Holland. They were probably mostly blue and white Chinese porcelains of the early Kangxi period, which until today is preserved in substantial numbers in the porcelain collection of the Munich residence. We get, however, some idea of the kind of pieces with which the elector furnished his Brussels palace, the former ducal and imperial palace of Kautenberg, whose interiors and collections he built up in the newest fashion. A list of works of art from the palace states next to old master painting, quote, several large porcelain pieces, comparable, you know, I just show you, such a typical garniture of Imari porcelain. There is also mention of a Chinese screen of 12 lacquer panels. I show you here an example, later example from the Munich collection, and two small wooden boxes which contained three small Chinese figures each. Of course, it's impossible to determine what it was. I just show you these Japanese mythological figures with celadon and brown glazes from the old Munich collection, but this is, of course, totally hypothetical. In terms of the reception and use of East Asian artifacts, which comes up to the style called chinoiserie, we acknowledge a short and consequent phase of Dutch chinoiserie at the court of Max Emanuel, but after 1697, when the peace with France was granted by the Treaty of Ryswijk, the archival records prove a massive import of French art and luxury articles, which Max Emanuel commissioned via his diverse Paris-based agents. And from then on, the Elector, as Governor General of the Spanish Netherlands, residing in close proximity to the Dutch ports of importation, would purchase lacquer and porcelain objects, usually mounted with fine metals in the French style, via the detour from Paris. On the other hand, archival and material proof is lacking for direct purchases of costly, high-ranking East Asian objects in the Netherlands. I have records for anything else, for Brussels lace, for spices, but never porcelain was mentioned in the records again. It's always bought in Paris. This seems paradoxical. It is, however, extremely revealing in terms of the cultural orientation of the prince. And now I'm going to present three cases of Parisian dealers. Max Emanuel's most important source was a Parisian marchand mercier, Laurent Danet, who was one of the very influential marchand merciers during the reign of the Sun King. Danet had been a specialist in hearthstone vases and old master paintings since the 1670s. He built up a wide-ranging European network of business contacts from Spain to Poland, and which allowed him to bring together objects of the highest quality for whose further refinement he only used the best artisans in Paris. Among the clients were Louis XIV, the Princess Conti, and the Grand Dauphin. At the very latest, in 1686, when the Siamese embassy created a true fascination for all that was Asian, Danet too began widening his stock to include East Asian works of art. However, French imports were still hindered by the chronic financial difficulties of Colbert's Compagnie des Indes, and therefore, we have enough archival proof that he often went to Holland to purchase porcelain and then stopped in Brussels to sell Max Emanuel mounted porcelain, which he brought over from Paris. The first contact between the dealer and Max Emanuel had created, in fact, by the Grand Dauphin. On 2nd January 1694, the Dauphin commissioned Danet to deliver a présent magnifique to the Brussels court, supposedly a wedding gift on account of the new marriage between the Elector and the Polish princess, Therese Conigonde. The gift was in fact a so-called cabaret, a type of circular tray, sometimes composed of two or three shelves on which services for hot beverages were displayed, all in accordance with the East or Asian origin of the type. The French court chronicler Sourges specified the object, quote, "We saw at the widowed Princess Conti the gift which Monseigneur would send to the Duke of Bavaria. It was both gallant and magnifique." The source goes on. "The cabaret displayed porcelain mounted with gold combined with precious watches and other objets de vertu, everything arranged beautifully and each object assigned a fixed place. With regards to the shape of this lost type of cabaret from Versailles, it is significant to refer to Dingliger's golden coffee service here in the green vault." Coffee service is today the epitome of a magnificent service, as it unites 45 vessels of gold and other costly materials, but also cups and saucers, enameled cups and saucers, which imitate concrete colors whilst being of European design. And of course, there's much to the idea that these Dresden creations have their origins at the court of Versailles. At any event, this gift of state of 1695 of the Grand Dauphin should be considered the beginning of the Bavarian collections of the kind. In 1698, Danet delivered a garniture of three vases of ancient Far Eastern porcelain mounted in gilt bronze, commanding the unheard price of 4,000 livres. I can just give you an idea. In the early 18th century, the average income of an artisan, a yearly income, was about 350 livres. So, I mean, 4,000 livres is an incredible sum. Comparison with another unmounted vase purchased for 400 livres highlights the profit generated by the dealer for mounting. On 1st March 1700, Danet supplied Maximilian with deux urnes d'ancienne porcelaine garnie de bronze doré, valued at 650 livres, probably to be identified with a pair of jaws with gilt bronze handles in the Residence Museum. The porcelain too is magnificent. It's of five color decorations, so-called Rusai of the late Ming Dynasty. But of course expensive were the gilt bronze handles with a super sophisticated design split in the middle, representing the finest quality in bronzes of the Grand Goût of the Louis XIV era, which is ever so rare to be found today. The description in the list of sold items could also relate to a pair of lidded jars. It is always worth noting the design and function of the gilt bronze mounts. We see here that the foot is held in a simple circular mount of gilt bronze. This then is linked at each side with thread work, and here the upper rim is always connected with hinges, and which could be actually also be detached from the porcelain, maybe for cleaning if it was in silver. The way of cutting, which seems of course always brutal to anyone who is interested in collecting East Asian porcelain, can be understood if we look here at the famille Vert vase, shoulder of the vase is now the upper part of the lid. This section here has been cut away. You have here the upper lid, which goes here, and the knob is replaced by a finial of gilt bronze. That's how it worked in Paris. They were much more deliverers of always ancienne porcelaine with ormolu mounts. The archival sources convey that Maximilian developed, in fact, a distinct taste for these exotic materials, and that he systematically collected Far Eastern porcelain. However, the sales list designate also always the pieces as ancien, that is antique as in old, and distinguish them from the more recently made wares called nouveau. The pieces were automatically classified as being of very high value by merit of this description. What is also important to pinpoint is that about 1700, the origin of the ceramic body, be it Chinese, Japanese, or Persian, was not yet a distinguishable factor in Paris. Only in the 1720s did Parisian mercers begin to distinguish porcelain by provenance. Before this, dealers and connoisseurs alike in Paris judged the visual characteristic of porcelains in relation to their rarity. Thus, that which was in fact Japanese was valued proportionally higher than all other porcelains due to its scarcity. Only the monochrome gray cracker glaze porcelain, which was greatly esteemed on account of being judged antique due to the cracks, was an exception to this rule. To Max Emanuel and the other members of the social elite, this symbolic quality seems to have been very little known. And there was in fact nothing scientific about the approach to these pieces. It might be rather compared to the idea of visiting, let's say, an Oriental bazaar. And this notion of an exotic world was of course promoted by the dealers with their shops, which bore such evocative names as A la Pagode, Gersin, Au Roi de Siam, Hébert, and my favorite shop name is Au Chagrin de Turquie, Duvaux. The biography of Max Emanuel follows as such. He lost during the Battle of Blenheim in 1704 and became, up to 1715, an émigré in Paris at the court of Louis XIV, and during those 8 years, he took full advantage of the Parisian art market. And the next mercer I want to present is named Jean-Baptiste de la Fresnay, who was also a member of a dealer's dynasty. And he kept a little shop at the Parisian Palace of Justice on the Ile de la Cité, which incorporated next to the royal legislation a commercial center comprised of little boutiques where between the 16th and the 18th century luxury items were offered. And while Danet's showroom probably looked more like the interior depicted in Gersin's shop sign, de la Fresnay had, you know, a little comptoir which was called A la Croix d'Or. And here, of course, you have the section for vases, but there was a similar section for silverware and for ceramics. His stock must have been sophisticated because he became Max Emanuel's preferred source for the purchase of luxury, gallant, and fashionable items now, whereas Danet was antique pieces. De la Fresnay sold also liquor, Indian boxes, and there's a lovely quote. On Christmas Eve of 1715, the Elector informed his Bavarian envoy in Paris that he wishes, quote, by the first courier, a déjeuner de porcelaine garni d'or sent directly from Paris. Furthermore, Max Emanuel told his envoy the best source of supply was de la Fresnay au Palais, as he himself would shop there personally, and he knew, of course, the stock. And what was mentioned, the Dijon de Porcelaine, relates, for instance, to the little teapot in Catlimon decoration, which is, you know, a single remaining piece of such a little tray for hot beverages. And a déjeuner was usually used, as the teapot tells you by its size, by one or two persons, so a very intimate encounter. 4 days later, the envoy received a nouvel ordre with the following details. His Highness wishes to have two tobacco pots mounted in gold with its matching spoons, which shall be sent by the next convenience. And here you have a marvelous gray crackle Chinese porcelain tobacco pot with exquisite silver mounts dated 1697 to 1704, hence an earlier commission of the Elector. I would also like to show you this little writing set and the inventaire après décès, so the inventory after de la Fresnay died in 1724, describes exactly this piece in Munich, comparable object in French, de porcelain naine blanche garnie d'argent sur son petit cabaret de bois de la Chine, la dite escritoire composée de trois pièces. And I'm grateful to Stefan Castelluccio for the reference that he published in his book, which I absolutely have to recommend, his book on called The Prince and the Marchand from 2014, where he interpreted the inventories of Danet and de la Fresnay, so I owe a lot to him. My third source now concerns, interestingly, a marchand financier named Pierre Messager, who had his shop in the rue Coquelière of the parish of Saint-Eustache. Messager also was part of a dynasty of marchand financiers, and Max Emanuel owed him the substantial sum of more than 10,000 livres. For the purchase of porcelain and glass. Usually, the marchand financiers at the time had faience, glass, and products from China in their stock. And so, I have the hypothesis that pieces such as this should have been a part of those quite substantial purchases with the marchand financier. Finally, now one note on the rich collection of mounted porcelain in the Bavarian collections from Max Emanuel's son, the Elector Charles Albert, later Emperor Charles VII, a collection which is limited to the year 1745, the death of Charles Albert. Although Charles Albert's artistic interests were less profound, he continued to commission luxury goods from Paris, profiting from the already established networks of contacts and dealers. The kind of incredible ensembles of mounted porcelain in the stateroom, in the new staterooms of the residence, fulfilled a new ceremonial function. These pieces were almost certainly delivered by an otherwise unknown marchand mirotier named Granier, from whom not only the costly trumeaux, the mirrors, were bought, but also the furniture, that is, the commodes, which you see here fitting below the mirrors, and the mounted porcelain garnitures to go with it. Unfortunately, I have only found the overall invoices for these acquisitions, which amount to about 60,000 livres. However, just one tiny little note, still a few unmounted pieces were acquired by Charles Albert in Paris, such as, of course, another mounted garniture with a faux dog, one of two, and the humble little equelle, little soup cup, as it's called, was acquired in 1739. I'm gonna show you here a comparable piece for 36 livres, but it's now called in Paris, as the dealers do, Porcelain du Japon. One just very brief note, which I came across recently. In 1728, the Munich court acquired Meissen porcelain in Augsburg again from the marchands Liebert and Weidemann. So I believe, you know, there's always an option for Augsburg playing an important part in terms of Oriental wares as well. The marchand Liebert later became ennobled. Johann Adam Liebert, Edler von Liebenhofen, who is also an important silver dealer, who was commissioned to deliver silver plate to the Munich court. Now to conclude, we may state that Far Eastern porcelains, of course, held a high-ranking position amongst the acquisitions made by the Munich court in the early 18th century. In collecting as well as displaying these Far Eastern rarities, be it porcelain or lacquer, the electoral court followed the criteria established by the French elite, notably at the beginning by the Grand Dauphin, which meant they were refashioned, that is, mounted in the French style. Yet, example of the single beautiful elephant of Japanese Arita porcelain in the collection here points out the remarkable difference between Max Emanuel and Augustus the Strong, because the Munich collection boasts two elephants mounted with gilt bronze, of course, as clocks, whereas the Bavarian court, at the Bavarian court, a new ceremonial use and meaning became attached to mounted porcelain. Augustus emancipated himself from the tradition by exhibiting no mounted porcelain at all in his Japanese palace. His aim, of course, was the promotion of his own manufacture, the Meissen porcelain. Unmounted, it goes without saying. I thank you for your attention.